Earth Day is right around the corner, and we're lucky to be joined today by an environmental policy expert. She's the former administrator of the EPA, also former governor of New Jersey, Christine Todd Whitman. Thank you very much for joining us.
It's great to be with you, Michael.
So last summer, President Obama introduced the Clean Power Plan, which is the goal of cutting carbon emissions by 32% from the 2005 levels by 2030. A lot of numbers there. Also, in November in Paris, there was the agreement between more than 100 nations to invest money to cut emissions on their own. That's going to be signed on Earth Day here in New York. So there's a lot of talk now about cutting emissions. It seems like this is ramping up over time. Do you feel optimistic that this is that we're going in kind of in the right direction as far as addressing this concern, where it feels like, you know, there hasn't been this much momentum in recent years?
Oh, absolutely. And you see it also with what's happening with businesses and the pressure that their shareholders on the publicly traded ones are putting on for what are you doing, what's your carbon footprint, how is your water usage, and the companies that are just going out on their own and saying, we need to do this. And it's something people are now becoming aware that this is a problem with which we have to deal. We can do it in a way that doesn't create our economy, and we need to be taking steps, and the public is starting to put that pressure on now.
And let's go back to the CPP, specifically what Obama has proposed. I wanted to talk to you about how that applies to New York, because Governor Cuomo has proposed even, more progressive or more ambitious goals for cutting carbon emissions. And I know you are the co-chair of Clean and Safe Energy. You guys advocate for nuclear power as clean and safe energy. And Governor Cuomo's goals, and same with President Obama's goals, make it very difficult to, it's very difficult to reach those goals if nuclear power is not kind of in the equation. Can you talk us a little bit through about what the impact of not having Indian Point online would mean for these goals?
Well, Indian Point provides 25% of the power for the New York City and Westchester, and 10% of the power overall, just Indian Point. Nuclear as a whole in this state is 30% of the power here, but 61% of the clean power. And there's really no way to replace that right now. And to meet the goals, Governor Cuomo's goals are far more aggressive. It's a 40% reduction. I don't see how he can meet the CPP targets without Indian Point, without bringing a whole lot more fossil fuel online, which is dirty. I mean, it's a whole lot cleaner than coal, don't get me wrong. It's much better than coal. The renewables are terrific, but they're not up to scale yet. And we're looking, given the dates for the Clean Power Plan, just given the dates for the projected increase in electricity demand, 22% by 2040, the renewables aren't going to be able to make that up. And they all right now need base power behind them because they're peak shaving. They only work when the climatic conditions are right. And so you have to have that base power, and you want it to be as clean as you can, and certainly Governor Cuomo does. And he wants to keep nuclear alive in the state of New York. It's only Indian Point that he wants to shut down.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit about this. I mean, obviously natural gas has been very cheap lately. This has had a very big impact on, I guess, the growth of nuclear power. But clearly natural gas has more emissions.
Right.
Do you see that there's going to be a fight that kind of develops there? Is it a situation where because natural gas is too cheap, people are going to continue to go that route and maybe not, bite the bullet as far as, investing in nuclear?
Well, until we have a national energy plan that says what we want is clean, green, reliable, affordable energy, this is going to be a problem because the utilities are publicly traded for the most part, and they have a fiduciary responsibility to shareholders on quarterly profits, and so they've got to take advantage of cheap energy. And making an investment in nuclear is a longer term. I mean, it does cost money, but any new power source is going to cost a lot of money because we are going to have a reduction in carbon, whether it comes in a hard cap or how it ends up after all the court battles. But one of the things that the Clean Safe Energy Coalition, is the Clean Power Resource Center, which is something we've just announced today, which actually breaks down for each state what it would take just to reach the Clean Power Plan goals.
Mm-hmm.
So in New York, that's about four times below what Governor Cuomo wants. And what you can see there is how you could, what would happen if you don't have your nuclear? What would happen as you take nuclear off? And what other sources you could put in? Because people have to, there are trade-offs with every form of energy.
Mm-hmm.
And people have to decide what trade-off they're willing to make and what makes sense for them. And when you have plants that have been operating safely, have always met the EPA standards for health and safety, that have been efficient, running at 91% at the time, you got to decide, okay, is that worth keeping online so that we can get clean air? Because clean air means healthier lifestyles for all of us, whether you believe in climate change or not. Let's just talk about health and clean air.
So when you look at kind of this larger argument, I mean, I think what I see happen all the time is that people talk about nuclear power, and there's still just some level of fear that's just kind of latent over the years. So, you know, how do you get past that? Do you still feel like that fear is there? Do you feel like people maybe don't make the connection that, you know, nuclear power, you know, has cleaner emissions, so maybe in a larger scale over time it would, you know, be safer than possibly, you know, the fear of just having like a nuclear meltdown because mm-hmm. the nuclear power plant's near you. I just feel like there's a little bit of a, you know, I guess an information gap that you see in the public.
Well, you're exactly right. That's what it is. It's a lack of information because we haven't really had nuclear as at the forefront of a discussion until now. And so people just don't know. And that's what CASE does. It tries to get into communities to just talk to them and answer their issues, answer their questions. I mean, when you talk about safety, nuclear has been deemed by outside sources one of the safest industries in which to work. Mm-hmm. The worst problem we have had with nuclear was Three Mile Island. Yep. And that was, first of all, generations of technology ago.
Yeah.
But when it happened, even when that happened, a partial meltdown in the core, the operators who were in the utility at the time standing there were not exposed to inordinately high levels of radiation. And they have been followed for the years since, the decades since. And there are no cancer clusters there. Mm-hmm. And they were standing right inside.
Yeah.
So the people on the outside were certainly safe. And after that, it was a wake-up call. It was something that never should have happened. It was a wake-up call to the industry, and the Nuclear Regulatory Commission has put in hours and hours of developing new standards, new safety standards, so that kind of thing can never happen again. The new technologies are better, the processes are better, and they're developing all the time, too.
Do you think politicians are still scared to some level, too, or scared that the voters are scared so they don't want to, you know, maybe put their neck out and support this? Do you think there's a gap there?
Well, but everybody is for. I mean, the president approves of nuclear. Andrew Cuomo wants his nuclear, except the one
that's close to
the
your
one
city.
Closest to the city. So it's not a partisan issue. At both sides of the aisle, obviously, you have those who represent the coal states, mm-hmm. or where natural gas is a big provider of jobs that are fighting against nuclear and don't want it. But if you look at what our challenges are as a country and our need for 24/7 power, it's an all of the above strategy. I mean, you can't walk away. Coal is 48%, 47% of our power today. You can't replace that overnight. We need to take advantage of low-cost energy because people depend on it to live with heating and cooling. And the rest of us all like our iPhones and our iPads, mm-hmm. and we like lots of power. And so we have to understand that it's going to be a mix. We need the renewables. They need to get more efficient. We need to be able to store that power, which we can't do now. We need to do more with conservation, but we need nuclear.
Is that a better argument maybe to make the people who, you know, have been opposed to nuclear for a long period of time and really want renewable energy to say, like, this is the best gap to get
it's
to?
It's a bridge.
Yeah, bridge, yeah.
It's a bridge, and I think that's fair. And actually, interestingly enough, while the environmental groups will never embrace nuclear, they're not fighting it in the way they did in the past because they care so much about climate change and mm-hmm. so much about clean air. And they recognize we're going to have nuclear. And so there's a lot less pushback than before, but the real key, at least at the federal level, the national groups, the national headquarters, the real key is to get into those communities where there's a licensing issue or a new renewal extension, and just answer their questions, because people are much more, and actually the most effective way to get people comfortable with nuclear, take them to a reactor. Because once they see the reality of it, once they see the redundancy and security, and in the whole way that a reactor operates, they come away saying, wow, I didn't know it was like that, and okay. And we've seen it again and again in any poll that's done in a community that benefits from nuclear power, and there was one done that even excluded people who worked at the reactor, and you had an over 85% favorable feeling about nuclear and willingness to add another reactor in that community, because they know it. They know it's safe. They know it brings in a lot of money and good jobs. The whole pipeline of jobs, you know, from janitor to nuclear scientist, they're all required there, and they pay on average 30% more than the same job in that community. So it's there are a whole lot of reasons that they feel very comfortable with it, and others need to understand that they just haven't been exposed to it.
On the larger public perception question, though, I know Gallup has been polling this for a long time, since 1994. For the first time, they had 54 Americans opposing nuclear power in a poll they did in March. Is that concerning to you? Do you feel like you're losing a public perception battle at all?
I really don't think, as if you look at it, there was another poll put out at the same time that had the reverse.
Yeah.
And it was how the questions were asked. When you ask nuclear from the perspective of security, people mix up nuclear power and nuclear weapons. Now, you can't take a nuclear rod and stick it in a missile. It doesn't work that way. They're totally different processes, but it's confusing for people. Unless you're involved, you don't know that. So you hear nuclear, and then you hear safety, and you start to think, uh-oh, I'm talking about nuclear weapons, because that's so much in the news with Iran and Iraq and North Korea. And so that's a legitimate concern, but you've just got to tell them the difference. But when you approach it and ask the question, as the other poll did, from an energy point of view, the result is just the opposite. People say, yes, it should be part of that.
And to be fair, the Gallup poll in 2015 actually had a 51% supported it. So it was a very, very big difference. I'm going to leave nuclear energy and clean energy right now and pivot to talk to you about the Republican presidential primary, which we can't really avoid at this point. You've been a very vocal, lack for a better term, critic of the Republican Party as far as the direction it's going. You've written a book about the party
and where
the way you thought it was going. I know you're supporting John Kasich right now. Mm-hmm. Instead of making the pitch for Kasich, I just wanted to ask you what you view the future of the party is, and do you feel like this primary cycle and maybe what happens in Cleveland could just dramatically impact the future of the party going forward? Because I think a lot of people had that narrative recently to say, like, you know, whatever happens in Cleveland could, you know, destroy the party, could lead to changing a party. Do you think the Republican Party is going to survive past Cleveland?
Well, something will survive, whether it's in the form that we know it today. I'm more worried about the future of the country than I am about my party. I care about the Republican Party, but I care about the country more. However, having said that, you don't know what's going to come out. I mean, this is a process. Everybody went into it knowing what the rules were. They're confusing. They're frustrating at times, this delegate selection process. It's a little more open on the Republican than the Democrat because we don't have these super delegates who are party insiders and who make their commitments early on. So it's a confusing process, but it's one that we've known what it was. And I know I can remember the 1964 convention, which got pretty contentious. And of course, you had the Democrats convention, the subsequent Democrat convention that were the riots in the streets of Chicago. So it's how this country has gone forward. And the Republican Party was a third party when it started. So anything can happen.
Mm-hmm. And you kind of, have a history of somewhat being a unifier as opposed to a divider. This seems like both the Republican and Democratic parties are moving in the division direction. Clearly, Congress is very divided right now. Do you think that is a trend, or do you think that maybe this is going to move back towards kind of unity down the road, or just even collegiality?
Unfortunately, I think it is. I mean, you mentioned my book. That was back in 2005, and this is exactly what I said was going to happen, and what I was concerned with is that the Republicans are moving so far to the right that it was hard to find that middle ground. And the Democrats, I was saying then, you know, watch out, gang. It's going to happen to you. And now it is with Bernie Sanders and Bill de Blasio and Elizabeth Warren. They're moving the party further to the left. The majority of the Americans are in the center. We know that from every study, every poll that's been done. And they're feeling more and more disfranchised, more and more frustrated. And people have got to understand that in a democracy, they're the ones who control it. And when you're angry and when you're frustrated, that's the one thing I will give to Donald Trump and to Bernie Sanders, is they have energized people into recognizing that the polling place is a place you can send a message. Mm-hmm. Because up till now, average voter turnout in primaries was 10%. And that's not the way to change things. Not voting is not the way to change things.
Finally, are you going to be in Cleveland?
I don't know. I'm running as a Kasich delegate at large. If his slate wins in New Jersey, I will be. If not, I won't.
Okay. Sounds good. Christine Todd Whitman, thank you very much for joining us.
A pleasure.